introduction. So hello all, good evening. Thank you for joining us back after a quick break. So this is the third session on the eGov partner training for the month of January 27, 2022. So here we're looking at, again, it's a continuation on the digit platform overview, but it's going to be more on the DevOps part of it, which is handled by Gajendran, our multifaceted maverick at the team. And he's going to be running on a quick overview of DevOps. How are you, managing your deployment? What is the infra sizing, which will be very interesting for you in terms of your planning as well and your monitoring aspect as well. So yes, like I said the last time as well, please feel free to put your questions in the chat and QA box or raise your hand, and we are more than happy to answer all the questions. And let's make this also as interactive as it was for the last session. So over to you, Gajendran, and I'll stop sharing. So the screen is all yours.
Sure. Thanks, Ajay. So thanks, Abhishek. Hope my screen is visible.
Yes, I can see the screen. Can somebody from the attendees also confirm the same? Yes, we've got a response from Tapujit. So yes, your screen is visible, Gajendran.
Sure. So hello, everyone. So welcome to the session on specifically DevOps area. By now, I think, since morning, whatever the sessions would have set a context on, what is the digit architecture look like, and what is the kind of, the tech stack that we are working on, and, the microservice architecture and stuff like that, right? So, when it comes to microservices, so there are a lot of advantages. At the same time, there are disadvantages as well, right? So advantages, obviously, you can have any number of services which are completely autonomous, that doesn't rely on, or that doesn't really depend on, some other service, right? From a release point of view or from a scale point of view. So as a developer or as a product owner, I can, individually enhance or, keep incremental changes within the particular service. That doesn't, depend on any other services go ahead or any other features go ahead and things like that. So that's a key aspect from a speed point of view, from a scale point of view, right? So what happens, when you build such a system, right, where there are, instead of one application that, you just install or you just deploy on one single VM or on a single machine, suddenly due to the microservice implementation, now it is 200 different services, right? You have to deploy them. So when you have to deploy, you need to really take care of the infrastructure, right? When I say infrastructure, what kind of infrastructures that it support, right? We should have a clarity on that. And next is, how are we going to deploy them? Because everything is autonomous. There is no interlink between the services. In that case, how are we going to still, make them talk to each other? And how are we going to scale? So for example, when I have hundreds of services, when I'm accessing a particular feature, for example, property tax, especially during the, a rebate period or during the peak hours. So in the entire system, property tax would be consumed more by the citizens because they have to pay the tax within whatever the stipulated time. So in that case, how the system is going to behave? How am I going to scale only the property tax services? How do I ensure that, we have sufficient hardware resources like CPU, memory, network speed, disk, everything available just for property tax, right? So all these are, different challenges when it comes to microservices. You can call them as challenges, or you can also see them as disadvantages of having a microservices-based implementation, right? Obviously, there are humongous amount of advantages wherein, like, you know, I can, there could be multiple focused teams or subject matter expertise who can go vertically and keep implementing, you know, changes across a specific area, right? So that's a very key benefit of a microservice. Second advantage is whenever you develop something, it is going to, you know, give you a result in a very predictable way, right? Whereas in a monolith kind of application, everything is API, right? I mean, there are different, you know, calls will be happening, and one API would call another API will call the another, I mean, some other API. So now the transaction path becomes little, you know, heavy, and due to which the predictability becomes a little question mark, because the resources are shared across different, you know, services or different APIs, right? So that becomes a very, you know, hard thing in a monolith kind of application. But whereas in microservices, when you say this is what it is developed for, and this is what the hardware resources it is going to consume in terms of CPU, disk, and memory, it is exactly going to take only that much of hardware resources, right? So that way it becomes very easy to predict the results, as well as you can specifically assign the, you know, infrastructure for that service to operate. And at the same time, you know, you can scale, you know, the same service vertically, horizontally, and all those capabilities will come in handy. So these are some of the advantages. Disadvantages are the challenges when something becomes more in number, right? So managing operationally and deploying them becomes a little challenge. So that is where, you know, we need better tools like Kubernetes, Dockers, right? So essentially, we are going to run each microservice in a container. That container will have only the sufficient, only the base required, you know, resources in a form of OS components or in any additional packages like Java or Golang or NPM, whatever is required for that service to, you know, just run, right? So it can be packaged into a container. It will just have only those, right? It will not have any additional component. So if we take our laptops, right? So we may be having any number of softwares installed. The OS is like, you know, very fat. You know, these days it comes in like 4 GB, you know, Ubuntu or Mac OS or Windows and things like that. But at a time, we may be using, you know, one or two, you know, applications, predominantly some browsers or some application which you use for, you know, used to code something or debug something. So rest of the time, all the hardware resources and OS resources are just there as a fat. So what is a container? Container is like very context specific. What is the service? Is that service is developed in Java, Golang, or some other, whichever the language. You can, another advantage of microservices, you can develop any service in any language, like Python or anything, right? So now, in that way, you know, you can specifically choose for a Python program to run, what I need, a base Alpine image, plus a Python is installed. That is more than sufficient for me, for my service to run. So now I'll package only this much into a container, and that becomes a very, very, you know, low weight container, component, or you can call it as a component as well. So now this is the way you are going to bake the containers for any number of services. Then what happens is you're going to get a predictable result, and you can also assign a specific CPU and memory for that particular container. Whenever it hits the 100%, the resources, you will know when it is going to hit 100%, CPU or memory, because you can literally, predict. You can hit the particular service in any number of times, and you can get the transactions, the maximum transactions it can process, and that way you can predict the CPU, memory, and whatever the other resources require. So this is how, we are going to package every service into a containers when it comes to a deployment focus, right? Now the services are built by the developers. Now, how are we going to deploy? So while we have to deploy, we have to consider these aspects, right? So we are going to bake it into a container, and we are going to make that as a Docker image, right? So obviously there are other technologies like Rocket and other technologies also you can use to containerize any particular application. The popular is Dockers, right? So this is the first step when it comes to deployment. Second is, now how are we going to run these or deploy these containers, right? So there are hundreds of services, all hundreds of Docker containers, are we going to put it in one single machine, or are we going to federate it across multiple machines, or is there a better, tools available, right? So that is when, Kubernetes come into a play. So Kubernetes is open source, which was, invented and used by Google for a while, and then they open sourced it. So it is never going to be, commercial at any point in time. It is already, given it to the open source community. So what it means is it's a very tested and, very reliable container orchestration platform, right? So that is what you can call Kubernetes as. So now you have many containers. Now Kubernetes provides a better orchestration. Now we are going to mix both, and that is how the Digit is deployed. That is what we recommend for a Digit as a infrastructure. So if you ask a question that Kubernetes is the only option, the answer is definitely no. Whichever the platform or whichever the solution that supports containers, right? For example, you can run containers in a Docker, Docker Compose, right? So, and you can run the individual containers on your local machines as well, right? On a Linux platform, LXC comes with the default, right? So there are several options available when it comes to, orchestrate the containers or deploy the containers and run it. So is it all just deploying? No, it is not just deploying. So once you deploy, you have to make each service talk to each other, definitely from a not directly talking, like in the monolith kind of application, it will be a API call from one service to another API call. But whereas in a Docker, there would be once the Docker is running, which means it can talk to the external world only through the REST APIs, right? So now how are we going to control all this authorization, authentication, and how are we going to discover, what services are there? And when I scale, one service into like property tax, when I need a property tax to be highly available during the rebate period, I want it in more replication. When I do that, there would be multiple instances of same container running, but still, how you know, other services can have a single point of entry or single point of communication. So this is all about orchestration, right? So that is what a Kubernetes provides. So this is a kind of a, you know, a context that you have to keep in mind when it comes to the deployment, infra sizing, and whatever the monitoring aspect that we are going to talk about, right? So I would, you know, strongly recommend, you know, the audience to go through the site that you're seeing on the screen called devops.digit.org, right? So this is, this kind of gives you from a very generic perspective, right? So what is Digit DevOps? And it starts from a general DevOps and then how the rise of technology, happened, and what is microservices, what are the advantages, disadvantages, and what is a cloud native applications, and what are some of the attributes of it. So you can have a walkthrough of this, and also there are digit specific topics which are backed up by certain videos as well, like what are the tools, and everything in Digit is open source tools. Whatever we use, right from what we code and what we, use for containerizing, what we use for deploying, what we use for monitoring, and whatever for CI, CD, everything, all the tools, whatever we use, it is a open source tools, right? So all those you can have a look at in this page, and what is the version of it, and what is the license type, and things like that. So this would probably, help you to visualize, okay, are there any proprietary softwares, or are there any lock-ins that could happen from a long-term perspective, or things like that, right? And similarly, there are other topics like, okay, now, how do I decide, what is my infra, whether it is going to be commercial clouds like AWS or Azure or, Google, or there are plenty of the commercial, cloud providers. And at the same time, there are, SDZs, NICs, from a government space perspective. Every state has got their own SDZs. Nationally, even NIC offers a cloud service. Cloud services. So which is my infrastructure? Which one will I choose? So the answer to that is, obviously it is explained in this page pretty much, but the answer is you can convert any sort of infrastructure into a Digit compliant infrastructure, provided that you can create a Kubernetes cluster in that particular infrastructure. Whether if it is a SDC, there are ways you can cluster, you can create a cluster of machines, and you can make that as a Kubernetes cluster, right? So why do we need a Kubernetes cluster? One is obviously it takes care of orchestration. Another is it takes care of your deployment automation. It takes care of your HA and DRS capabilities. So when I say HA and DRS, for example, I have hundreds of my services are running. I don't want a manual intervention, or my operations person should sit and monitor whether everything is running properly or not. If something is going down, should I restart them or should I redeploy them? So all those capabilities, it comes out of the box from Kubernetes, right? So it takes care of all. So now, to create a Kubernetes cluster, so there are certain specific documentation which you may have to read, and you have to convert your existing machines into a Kubernetes cluster. So what it requires is for a Kubernetes cluster itself, right, to manage all this orchestration and taking care of your HA and DRS and monitoring your deployment automation, it requires certain CPU and memory requirement, and which we call it as Kubernetes master, right? So which is a kind of a excellence that is required to take care of all this requirement. And then the next comes is the worker nodes. Worker nodes are actually the nodes which is going to hold your workloads of your particular application, right? For an application, if there are hundreds of microservices, so these worker nodes, this will take the complete load of your applications and the microservices that you're running. So let's say for an instance, I have 10 microservices. Each microservice, it requires 200 micro CPUs and 300 MB of memory, right? For my service to run, right? Likewise, there are 10 services. Now, how do you arrive at the infra estimation or infra sizing? It's a simple math, like 200 micro CPUs into 10 and 300 MB of RAM into 10, right? So that's going to give you the total number of CPU and memory required for this. And if there are any services like databases, right? Database or some file upload service. So if it requires a disk space, so that is when you need to plan for a specific disk space. So imagine there is a file uploader service that generally, takes PDFs and as an input and persists into some space. So now this is how you are going to decide on the disk space. It should be physical, this one. It can be an external a storage as well. Generally, all these cloud providers will have elastic block storages, and there are iSCSI storages and stuff like that, depending upon whichever the cloud infrastructure you are in. So you can actually create, for example, I have one service, a file uploader, which initially would take about 30 GB. This is what I am estimating from a number of users and number of the load that I'm anticipating. So I can, let's say I arrive at 30 GB in the initial period, and down the line, it is going to grow about 300 GB. So you should have a plan for that. What is the first 3 months or 6 months, 30 GB. And it is obviously all the EBS and everything elastic. It is elastic block storage, right? You can actually keep increasing the size. So that's how you can arrive, what is your kind of anticipation of the load, and what is your go-in strategy in the initial, and how are you anticipating the load in next 1 year or 6 months or things like that. And that's how you can plan the storage as well. It's also true for both CPU and memory, right? So when it comes to CPU and memory, you can plan two ways. One, you can plan vertically, or you can plan horizontally as well. So when I say vertically, as per the example I said, 200 micro CPUs, you can actually increase it to 400 micro CPUs. So imagine it's a property tax service. So at that particular time, I want to increase the CPU and memory of the same container. So which is a vertical scaling, right? You reserve more CPU and memory for that. You allocate more CPU and memory for that. Second approach is you can create multiple replications of the same service. So property service, the memory and CPU would remain same, 200 and 200 micro CPUs and 300 MB of RAM. I will have two replicas of the same running, or three replicas of the same running. So this, you can do it on demand, or you can actually put some intelligence that if I know per container with the 200 micro CPUs and 300 MB, it can take only 100 concurrent requests, right? You can put a rule that whenever it crosses beyond 200, the incoming, you know, the request, you replicate it by one more, right? And you monitor the second replication as well. When that becomes 100 to 200, replicate in one more, right? So this is one way of putting rules. Second approach is, okay, so whenever I hit the CPU and memory of like somewhere between 90%, 90 to 95, you know, replicate into one more, right? So these are different ways wherein you can configure your auto scaling capabilities. And this is again comes from Kubernetes as a capability, right? So Kubernetes has all these components like HPA, horizontal pod auto scaling is a feature and vertical auto scaling as a feature. So obviously the metrics should be, you know, configured. Metrics are nothing but the rules, right? Should it be based on a traffic or should it be based on a memory resources and things like that, right? So first requirement when it comes to how do I decide my infra, right? So obviously there would be differences when it comes to whether it is SDC or NIC or, you know, commercial clouds like AWS or Google or Azure or things like that. Because in SDCs, mostly it is a kind of a static environment, right? Like it'll have a, you know, for example, it'll have a generation, I don't know, some generation of machines, the hardwares, right, which is bought. And all of a sudden, you know, in SDC kind of infrastructure, the machine upgrades will not happen that frequently. And that is not a very easy solution when it comes to SDCs, because all are kind of static. It is, you have purchased it and for 5 years you have to live with this. It is true for every other components, like whether it could be a CPU generation or memories or network. There are plenty of ways. Ethernet, you can use fiber nets and things like that. And even when it comes to disk, there are, you know, SSDs and HDDs and stuff like that, right? So from that context, every SDC's infrastructure is not same. And when we compare from SDC to commercial clouds, obviously there would be differences in the same application. Everything is running on Kubernetes. It is deployed in SDC and commercial cloud. There would be differences depending upon all these criterias, right? So these are some of the evaluation aspects that you would consider when it comes to choosing the infrastructure, right? So maybe, you know, for a kickoff, for the just initial going strategies, like you can, you know, go in with the SDCs and slowly you can, you know, just monitor the efficiency and effectiveness of the entire solutioning. And then you can slowly, you know, compare the other tools as well when it comes to, you know, the states, because states, they already have certain infrastructure, right? Preferably they would ask, you know, they would prefer to go with SDCs, right? Similarly, NIC has a comparatively better, and NIC is again, you know, from an elasticity point of view, NIC also, you know, keeps working on upgrading all these hardwares and bringing in a lot of managed services kind of capabilities. Like Kubernetes, if you want on NIC, it is a managed service. So you don't need to sit and create a, you know, Kubernetes. But whereas in SDC, you have to provision your own SDC, the Kubernetes cluster first, and then you have to add your worker nodes depending upon the workload requirement of your application. So, but whereas when it comes to commercial clouds, it is like you will have a complete freedom and the elasticity is more there. You can choose what is the machine type that you want, and you can also choose the price. There are multiple price buckets, like you have reserved instances, you have on-demand instances, you have spot instances. So when it comes to cost, right, when it comes to budget, or like you have a estimation about, you know, for the quarter, this is the estimation, you have such, you know, kind of restrictions. So the commercial clouds will come in handy, where you can, you know, decide what kind of infrastructure would give you a very low, I mean, from a cost perspective, how you can provision a cost-effective infrastructure and things like that. So these are some of the aspects from choosing the infrastructure, right? And next is sizing. So how are we going to size it? As I said, you know, we have a kind of a baseline. So for example, as you're seeing in my screen, you know, for example, we have these many number of services, right? For example, I have just a grouping, you know, I have categorized some of these services as backbone, because without this digit will not come up, right? Like I need a zookeeper for my Elastic, for my Kafka, and Redis I need for my authentication tokens and stuff like that. And certificate manager, this is for your SSL certificate. So likewise, there are these many number of services, and these are number of replicas, right? And these replicas would change from a dev to UAT to prod, because in prod I want more HA, right? I can actually come in the sheet and I can just update it. So this is for a prod. What you're seeing in the replica column D is for the prod. But whereas for my dev, I need just two replicas of the same. Likewise, you can decide. And do you need a QA environment? Again, like you can, you know, add another section for QA because I have a QA team, or initially I don't have a QA team. Do I do a UAT or do I do a dev environment? So all this various aspects you will come here and key in, and then finally you arrive at the number of, you know, the total number of services for backbone, total number of services for infra. So these are just category. Infra, when I say, here is where we'll put certain monitoring tools like Grafana or Prometheus, which can, you know, help you what's exactly happening, what is the CPU and memory consumed by each service. So these are some of the generic tools which are available in the open source world. If you ask me, should I use only this? No, you can use any of your choice. There are obviously plenty of tools. So this is just for your reference, right? So not necessarily that you should only use these. But whereas Digit, yes, Digit is from as a product, right? So we have a core which lays the basic platform, and then on top of it there are some business services like billing, HRMS, analytics dashboards, and finally the category of municipal services like, you know, property tax, water and sewerage, and things like that. So you have to put, like, for example, I need a Rainmaker in my production and I want it in two replicas because I'm anticipating that initially, my initial transactions, I mean, concurrent users would be 300. So as I know, you know, one container or one replica can take 150. So now, likewise, you know, you would make a calculation and then you decide how many, number of replicas. So initially, I mean, in the actual scenario, it is UL based, right? So there could be, you know, aggressive ULBs, there could be slow ULBs. So you can't arrive, if you ask, like, you know, can you convert number of ULBs into number of transaction? The answer is no, right? Because as I said, aggressive ULBs and there are slow ULBs, and there is a kind of time it will take to educate the ULBs to utilize the system, or so adoption of the system will take time, right? Depending on that, so you need to consider essentially what you should arrive at is what is the TPS, transactions per second, right? So based on that, you know 150 is the TPS that one replica can take. And now whatever the TPS that you're arriving at, so depending upon that, just put those many number of replicas and stuff like that. So once you do that, in the next sheet, you know, it is going to tell you that what is the per service. So in backbone category, whatever the services that you saw, each service, you know, it takes about, 0.2 millicore, right? Likewise, the memory requirement is 512 MB, right? So automatically, depending upon how many ever the replicas that you have chosen here, right, in the D column, it's going to, consider, it's a math, like, as you can see, it just takes the value from the total number of replicas, right? The replicas which are coming from here. So 27, right? It just takes all the number of replicas here, and it just straight away does the math of, multiplying it and giving you the final numbers, right? And what is buffer? So for example, if you want to keep some buffer, so this is the kind of actual, and this is some kind of buffer that you would like to consider because it's a very dynamic, right? So as I say, aggressive ULBs and non-aggressive ULBs and adoption rate. So depending upon that, you can actually consider this, buffer. And so you can also change this. So for example, as we release multiple versions of the same platform, right? We might do certain performance improvements as well. So for example, when we release version, let's say the current version is 2.5 and tomorrow we are releasing 2.6, where we have done certain performance improvements, which resulted as kind of like, it doesn't need, this much, right, for a backbone. So that's how it automatically, so it just accordingly, you can manage this essentially, for your environment, you should have this calculator. So we are saying, this is our performance baseline in this release, or you can also have your own performance team because you have customized things and you know better, you should also have certain performance baselines, right? So I have customized, for example, municipal services. So wherein I have added a lot of customization, it has added little overhead. That means from the default 0.2 to 0.3 it has become, right? So all these things you should be able to do it. And finally, here you should be able to get those, okay, depending upon whatever the various parameters and the criteria that you have set here, it is going to give you the, for dev environment, finally, what is that I want as a worker node. As I said, Kubernetes comes as a two piece. One is master, where if you don't have a managed service like in AWS or NIC or things like that, this infra you have to consider additionally because you are going to provision a Kubernetes master first, right? Which will have just the capabilities. It's a Kubernetes software itself. And the worker node is actually the, it can take the load of your actual services and things like that. So this would be kind of a static. So wherein for every environment, we need at least 3 VMs to make it HADRS. If you ask me, should I really need 3? You can also go for 1-1 because 3 quorum always, makes a, high availability, right? If one goes down, another takes care. If 2 goes down, there is a third one. So the possibility of both going down is very, 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 very less. So that's how in typical HA practice, always it's a 3 quorum is what considered as a HA. So with that, you can go with 3 VMs. So Kubernetes always replicates every component in all 3. If one goes down, other picks up and things like that. Because of that, you need three. But if you again have a kind of a restriction on the machine, number of machines and things like that, you can also go with one, provided that you will have your production, you can keep three. But provided there would be certain risk and which you may have to, you should be ready to take it up, right? So this is in the case of non-managed Kubernetes, right? If it is a managed Kubernetes service, all you need to worry about is, okay, I need a Kubernetes as a service, and now I just need to decide on how many number of worker nodes that I should add. So this is where, like, you know, there are multiple categories, like, you know, okay, so first I'm anticipating as, you know, somewhere between 0 to 50 ULBs, which is kind of translating into 750 transactions per second, right? So if that is the case, then I would turn on this and make all others zero. Then it's going to give you what is the total number of CPUs, memories, and disks, and which again converts into number of machines. So the number of machines, it depends upon what VM templates that you have. For example, you know, I have in the particular SDC or in a particular cloud infrastructure, I have only certain VM templates, like, you know, all machines are, you know, 4 CPU and 8. So in that case, what you would do, just do a math again, total number, whatever is coming. So like 19 divided by 4, that's going to give, tell you, like, you know, 4.7, right? So depending on that, you decide the number of VMs. So sometimes what happens, based on our experience, so in SDCs, number of machines would be restricted, whereas they can give you more, you know, CPU and memory within the same machine. So in that case, you can come here and, you know, choose whatever you want. So there is absolutely no impact. But at least, you know, again, from a HA point of view, if you at least have distribute the workloads into at least three machines, right? It gives you a better, you know, HA and DRS capabilities, right? Whereas in commercial space, commercial clouds, we prefer to have at least two regions, right? So I have one region, I mean, I have one machine from a Mumbai region, another machine from a Delhi region. Still, you know, I can make a, you know, so you can, when you do that, what happens when there are any, you know, unnatural disasters or whatever happens, so it will still, you know, keep your infrastructure, you know, highly available, up and running and things like that. So these are some of the, you know, key considerations when it comes to, you know, infrasizing and deciding on the, you know, scale part of it, and HA and DRS part of it and things like that. Yeah, so right, so with this I'll give a pass here, and we'll see if there are any questions or if there needs to be any, I mean, any clarifications required on the specific areas or things like that. Abhishek?
Yes, Gajendran. I had seen, I guess it was Sumit who had raised his hand for a question. Or if anybody has questions, please raise your hand. Yes, I am. Yes, Sumit, you can ask your question.
Yeah. So, hi, Gajendran. I basically have a question regarding the scaling. See, we generally do scaling at the API node or the non-persistence side of the story, right? But when it comes to Postgres, right? Postgres is not horizontally scalable, right? So then how do we deal with that sort of a limitation when it comes to horizontal scaling in terms of a microservices deployment here, right? Because see, what I have understood in terms of the existing code and the existing deployment, whatever I've been able to understand and read through, is we deploy multiple different services as tenants, right? So separate nodes are deployed, or is it a single node for the entire state? Like, for example, if I go for a bigger state, like, for example, if you consider UP, right, which is a highly populous state. So in that case, what would be the deployable model like? would I deploy a single sort of a end-to-end sort of a service, like not a service, the deployment would be for the entire state or for every ULB or district, I would say probably different deployments will happen. How would it work is what I wanted to understand, because there is always that limitation of the persistence layer, right?
Yeah. So to the two questions, right? So how do you kind of horizontally scale persistent services, right? Like Postgres. So Kubernetes does give you an ability that, you know, you are all, I mean, you can have the service replications in multiple, but there could be one single persistent volume, okay? Everything will you can even replicate the persistent volume as well, so that the duplications are available in multiple, you know, the persistent volumes as well. So both are possible. It is the capability in Kubernetes. So there would be a persistent volume and there would be a persistent claim, right? So PVCs and PV. So that's how Kubernetes manages, like, though there is one single persistent volume, but the actual replication of the same service is more, how is it going to, you know, manage the data and the stuff like that? Kubernetes takes care of that. So second question.
Sorry. So see, I just have that one clarification. Postgres itself does not support horizontal scalability. There's a limitation wherein there is only one master node that is allowed. You could have several read nodes or non-primary nodes, but only a single node could be a master at any given time. So that limitation cannot be surpassed even by Kubernetes, right? So that is where the entire question has sort of come from.
No, not really, right? So see, why do you have to have Postgres as a master and read, right? If at all you want to have it, you can still have it, okay? But it doesn't restrict you to have a number of masters, right? So at the end of the day, Postgres is a single service within the Kubernetes. So you will refer to Postgres, whether it has got a Postgres pod 1, pod 2, pod 3, it doesn't really matter. So don't see Postgres as a separate entity. Postgres, just see Postgres as just like any other service within the, just like any other service which is containerized and things like that, okay? So that's the answer for that. But wherein what you're saying is, if you want to deploy a Postgres as a, HADRS thing, Postgres as a capability, right? So Postgres as a capability, you know, it gives you a default template, you know, where you can have one master and multiple, you know, read replicas or things like that, which is a kind of a high availability Postgres capability. But there is no interlock between how you can scale applications inside the Kubernetes and how you can deploy a high available Postgres within a Kubernetes. There is a difference. Maybe, you know, you will have to figure out the differences in it. But what I can say is, Postgres as a container, it is no different from any service that you deploy on a Kubernetes, okay? But all is gated through one single service, right? Kubernetes service. The requests come to Kubernetes service and the service will decide, okay, which container or which pod that I should write the traffic to, okay? So hope that kind of gives you some 50% clarity, and rest you will have to figure it out, you know, what is the difference in, you know, the Postgres as a high availability that you deploy on a Kubernetes. And like you deploy a Postgres just like any other service, right? You need to find out this distinction. Okay. You will get the answer for it.
Okay. So the second question that I had, Gajendran, was Like, for example, what would be the minimum? Like, if in the last section, I don't remember the name exactly. The guy mentioned that you could basically run it on a 16 GB RAM locally for the development purposes, right? So now in this case, because there are multiple services, and I'm probably doing an integrated development across different things, and I probably may be touching several things. So what would be the best approach to sort of run everything locally, or is it even possible?
See, you can obviously run things in things locally, right? So provided that you should have a sufficient, you know, the there are documentations around that will tell you the minimum requirement for your local machine, right? So for a dev like environment, or you want to troubleshoot or debug, right? You can pretty much for a digit kind of setup where there are about, like, you know, somewhere between 40 to 60 services, depending upon you selectively choose something. So somewhere, like, if you have a 4 vCPUs and 16 GB of RAM, where, like, you already your OS has taken about, like, you know, 30 to 40% of it already is consumed by that, and remaining you have this, then you can very well, you know, run the dev like digit inside. Hello.
Yep.
Yeah. So dev like you know, setup in the local machine, right? In a laptop, whether it is Windows or whatever it is. So at least you should have a 4 CPUs and 16 GB RAM.
Okay.
In your local machine. So there is a capability called K3S, which is a kind of a tool which you can install in your local machine, which will convert your local machine into a Kubernetes cluster. Okay, so there are documentations. It is there in the docs.digit.org. Yeah, you can refer this quick start, right? So it can tell you, you know, how to, so like K3D, sorry. So K3D, how you can install on Windows or Mac or Linux, and what is the minimum and maximum thing, right? So yeah, so minimum is 8 GB, but we always recommend 8, this one, and 4 vCPU, but we still recommend 8. This is because, you know, sometimes what you're running in your local machine, right, it is, if it has already consumed a lot, then, you know, it's very difficult. But you know, when we say 4 vCPUs minimum, but recommend 8 vCPU, just with this, you should be able to run complete setup, at least dev-like setup in your local machine. And that too, it will give you a seamless experience. If you refer this document and install it, it'll create a Kubernetes cluster in your single box, right? And the same is true, you know, when you have to do the same thing in a kind of a cloud infrastructure also. If you think that I need to deploy all the digit services in one single box, so that is also possible through this approach. Okay, so okay. Just refer this, it will give you a little detailed insights. I will paste this in the chat as well, or you will take care of this, Abhishek.
Yeah, I'll paste it in the chat for us.
Okay, so any other questions?
Anoop Kumar had a perspective. He says, I believe we should archive the older data from Postgres to Cassandra in an interval. That way we can manage this limitation. I think it was more to do with your previous conversation.
Right. So there are a number of ways, but the Cassandra approach, or there are a number of ways. Okay, so... But you will know better, you know, when you have to decide based on the situations that you from a technology point of view and from a possibility point of view, definitely yes.
Okay. That kind of brings us to the dot. We are exactly at 5 p.m. now. So is the session done, Gajendra?
Yeah, so the final piece what we have is the monitoring. So I can just give a quick overview on monitoring. So another capability, I mean, another key challenge that it comes in mind when there are number of, you know, services which are running in an infrastructure, right? How will we, you know, track them, or how do we get to know how, what is going wrong, or which is performing well, which is not performing well? This is where you need a, you know, monitoring as a key capability, right? So that's again covered in these topics from 11 to, you know, 14. When I say monitoring, it is from, it's actually an observability point of view, right? Where you can monitor logs, you can trace services, what exactly is happening, and you can alert things, you know, when something goes wrong, right? All those capabilities, we have, you know, set some certain exemplars, which again comes as a add-on components for you whenever you deploy something, whenever you deploy Digit, you can also deploy them additionally. Obviously, it'll have a little, you know, additional infra requirement for that, because those are also services which will be running. Certain daemon sets will be there. For example, the way the logging works is we use a Fluent Bit that always, you know, pulls the data, pulls the logs from the, you know, nodes. Every container generates a log, which is again stored in a particular VM. And if there are more worker nodes, it will pull the data from all the worker nodes, and it will push it to some Kafka topic. And from Kafka topic, we will, you know, read it in Elasticsearch, and Kibana will dashboard it, right? This is for logging. And similarly for tracing, we are using, you know, Jaeger as a capability, which is again an open source. So that at a API gateway level, we will have a correlation ID, which would be enriched in the request. And as and when every request reaches every, like in a, for a property tax, if it is touching some 10 different services. So with that correlation ID, we track, we trace the complete transaction path, and we just, the entire path, we dashboard it in Jaeger. So at any point in time, you can, for a property tax to be filed, I mean, paid, what was the total duration took, and how each services, you know, took service, I mean, the time, right? So even that is tracked. But alerting, again, we use Prometheus operator capability. And infra monitoring, we have, again, Prometheus and Grafana. So these are some of the exemplars which you can, I mean, instead of you struggling and getting it all done through internet, we have, yeah, we have set some examples you can, which you can leverage. But you know, this is not something that, you know, we are, what we are offering, right? Digit is our product, but monitoring and all other things, it is just an example which you can also follow it and get it done for your when you do the implementation. But if you ask me that, should we use only these capabilities, or can we use any other cloud provider specific capabilities? The answer is definitely yes. For example, if you are using AWS, you know, AWS provides, you know, the default logging capabilities and dashboarding it capabilities. So you can obviously implement that. But these are some of the open source ways and cloud agnostic way of monitoring and stuff like that. Okay, so people, most of the time, you know, people misunderstand that, you know, all this Prometheus and Grafana or all these monitoring capabilities are part of the Digit product. So it is not a Digit product as such, but it is general, you know, available tools which is there in open source community, but we have implemented based on our best analysis and better implementation perspective. You can decide which suits better for your kind of infrastructure and your kind of skills. Like you might have a person who knows Prometheus and Grafana better, he can adopt this. Or if you have a person who knows that other tools, then they can also do that. But I can give a quick walkthrough of how it looks. So for example, we have a UAT environment, UAT node.digit. So with any application, if you have deployed all those monitoring and this one, you just by giving the context path as logging or things like that. Okay, the service is not running right now. So all you need to do is come here and give the context path as monitoring and logging and things like that. It will take you to that particular dashboard. For example, monitoring, what all I can monitor here. When you go to dashboards, so there are I want the Kubernetes ingress controller will give you the traffic details, and the cluster overview will give you the cluster consumption, how each services are consuming, like overall cluster status. There are so many nodes and what is their memory and CPU the consumptions. For example, my backbone is taking 3 GB, like EGov services consuming 59 GBs of RAM, things like that. And you can also go by specific nodes as well. And there are several dashboards built, like which service is taking whatever, like how much time it is taking and what time the loads are coming. So all these capabilities are dashboarded here. And this is a monitoring of a cluster itself. And another is the traffic. So what is the IOPS, right? The current traffic is this much and which service is consuming the, the more traffic, like billing service, 0.01 request per second, citizen collection service. So it will give you by every service, you should be able to monitor this. So these are some of the similar dashboards that you can also build by using the tools like Grafana and Prometheus, right? With this, I think I would like to conclude the topics. And I can see if there are any questions, and then it should be good. Abhishek?
Yes, Gajendra, we just give them a minute to see if anybody has questions, but yeah. There are no pending questions as such.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sure, so do refer these sites, both the sites. One is devops@digit.org. Another is docs.digit.org. The difference is you will get a holistic view of a digit right from the architecture and the various customization configuration capabilities. And DevOps is purely focused on, a DevOps as a practice, right? So a person who's new to the system and wants to understand DevOps, even they can get a little bit of gist about what is DevOps, and also slowly how things are done, how DevOps practice is implemented within Digit, right? So that's also available here. Yeah, So these two, and you can share this infra calculator template, base template, right? This might probably give them a kind of a, it could be just a help. But again, like, you know, don't purely depend on this. But it is all, I just showed the technique, you know, how you can actually do it. So this is true for any microservice kind of an application. You have to go by every service, how much it is taking, and then you should arrive at the similar exercise you have to do to arrive at, right? So you can use this as a base template and decide. So this is about infra sizing. Yeah?
Yep. Gajitan, we have one question. I don't know the name of the attendee. The question is, does Kubernetes not need Zool, internal gateway, or Eureka service? Is it correct?
No, Kubernetes, we are using Zool gateway, as a Zool as a API gateway, but you need a API gateway, okay? So, I mean, it depends, like, you know, you want an API gateway, if you want to do auth-z and auth-n. If you don't want it, you don't use it, right? Second is, do you want Zool only? No, you can use, you know, any of the similar, you know, the API gateways. If you already have an API gateway, you know, something, a state says, no, you have to go through this. Yeah, you have to implement it. But what by default in Digit that comes as a package is Zool. So Zool is again an open source, which we have utilized it. If there are anything better, you can replace. So that comes as a customization. Hope that answers.
Yes, I guess just that. And like Gajendran was mentioning, the link to the infra calculator and digit.dogs or devops.digit.org is all given in the chat and also in the registration template that has been shared with all of you. So each session has a reference link there. Request all of you to make maximum utilization of that. Kind of like, have you, as you've seen, most of the content and the conversation was around these web pages and the infra calculator itself. So kind of, you know, it allows you to deep dive into all of this. So yeah, with that note, we don't see more questions. Gajendran, we'll call it a day then. I think even the attendees have been on from 11 in the morning. So yeah, thank you so much.
Unfortunately, this is in the end. People might be already tired from the mind. Yeah, but it's okay.
But it was good. It was enjoyable. And so, yeah, thank you, Gajendran, and thank you, everybody, for joining the session. Kind request, please do answer the survey questions. And we will see you after breakfast tomorrow at 11 o'clock with the four product demos handled by our product team. That's Finance, MCollect, Property Tax, and OBPS. So, yes, please go through the reference links. It kind of preps you up before the training session as well. So you'll have more questions or be able to much more relate better to this. So on that note, thank you all. Thank you, Gajendran. And let's all have a safe and good evening then. Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, guys. Have a safe evening. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye, all.